Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Beep. I'm sorry, what? Yeah. Close Encounters of the First Kind. I will be back at the table at the end of this, I promise. Just to meet some of you, hear your stories. I want to do something before we get into this. How many of you have had an encounter with a UFO, seen lights in the sky, sleep paralysis, had an encounter with an entity? Raise your hand and keep them up. Keep them up. Yeah, look around the room. Keep them up and look around the room. This is the dirty little secret in the church. Every place I've ever gone, it's the same thing. I remember sitting at Pastor John Kilpatrick's church, and his son came up to me after the first session, and he went, "L.A., I couldn't believe it. When you asked the people," because he's in the front row, "to raise their hand, I figured, ah, it'd be one or two people." It's like 30% of the church had their hands raised, and he's going like, "Oh, my gosh." Once you see one, you'll never forget it. Some people see them, and they just go, "Nope, I didn't see that, not doing that. Can't make me do it." So I'm a Boy Scout. Hall's mentholated eucalyptus leaf cough drops. So I'm a Boy Scout, I'm like 11 or 12. Camp Horseshoe, Rising Sun, Maryland. And we're taking this shortcut back to the camp, because it's lunchtime, and 12-year-old boys like lunch, big time, right? So we're jumping over these boulders and stuff, and we're going up this dry creek bed. It's really cool. And there's four of us. I'm the last boy, three guys in front of me. The one guy goes, "Wow, what's that?" The other two boys go, "Wow, what is that?" And I go, "Where?" They go, "There." I look up, classic silver disc, classic sitting there, hovering about, if I go like this, it's about the size of my thumbnail. So give it, just classic silver disc, sun glinting off of it. We watch it for maybe 20 seconds, 25 seconds, and the thing goes like this, gone. Oh my gosh, we go running back to the camp. We saw a flying saucer, we saw a UFO. All the kids come out of the cabins. Where, what did you see? The scout masters are there. We're telling the story, we're all hyped up and excited. That's lunchtime. By 5 o'clock at the evening meal, the other three boys denied that they had ever seen anything because of the ridicule. Yours truly refused to back down. And they called me UFO boy and all sorts of other stuff. I don't care. I know what I saw. And what is the truth? I'm not backing down. This was something. That was the first one. The second one was with my wife where, you know, the rebuke first, ask questions later. The third one, and I don't go looking for this stuff like some people. I don't want to see any of it, okay? I don't. I was going to do something, but I'm not going to go there. So, you know.
Do it.
Yeah, so, that's a little limp on your shoulder.
It's okay. Go ahead and do it. No one will ever know. Just go ahead and do it.
So, LA, where do these voices come from? Maybe we need Russ Dizdar here. So, where was I going with this? So the third one, we're driving on the John Kilpatrick Highway in Oklahoma City. And it's a beautiful road, really maintained really well. And you kind of come out of OK City in Edmond proper, and then you're in this sort of wilderness. It's really not wilderness, but there's no houses, there's no street lights, there's woods on both sides. And so Peggy, I'm driving, Peggy's in the driver's, or the passenger seat, and she goes, wow, what's that? And I look over, and I see this like spotlight thing on the trees, and I go, oh, it's probably one of those, you know, car dealerships with the lights. Wrong. And then I realize that there's no car dealerships where we are, and how would they shine the light on the treetops anyway? And we're driving along like this, and this thing is bouncing like this, and it's pacing us like this. And we both realize we're not in Kansas anymore. And Peggy goes, typical, I'm the great spiritual leader of the house, right? And Peggy goes, we need to pray. And I go, oh yeah, that's what we need to do. Thanks, honey. I almost forgot. So we prayed, and the moment we prayed, bam, it was gone just like that. So rebuke first, ask questions later. This is me. Hello, me. But this is my first proper archaeological dig. That's a trowel. That this is a fire pit, firecrack rock. There's the ash. This is at Judah Color Rock in North Carolina. L.A., have you ever had bald peanuts? Bald peanuts? No, that's right, bald peanuts. You mean bald peanuts, Mr. Marzulli? I love in the South, they go, we got L.A. Marzulli here. That's Marzulli, so that's what I said, L.A. Marzulli. So there I am at Judah Color Rock. Here I am in the archives at Madison, Wisconsin. And here I am at Paracas, Peru. We found this in the Chongos Acropolis. We found the skulls laying on the ground. They got spooked by something, so they just let everything go. And because we saw the tire tracks, and they just hightailed it out of there. There were three skulls that were there. They were in the Senior Juan's Museum. So I've never done that before, so I thought I would just do it. So there's some of the films, there's some of the books. Once again, to expose the deception of the Prince of the Power of the Air, herald the return of the King. Our trip to Israel is closed. We've got 45 people. We're going only one bus because it keeps it intimate. And thank you for coming. So something is coming. Is America finally ready to take UFOs seriously? And I've been to the little alien. Several times. And what was really interesting was I was there in the 90s, and I was just starting the research really seriously for what would come the Nephilim book, the first book in the trilogy. And so I was there at the little alien, and I was just blown away, but I was learning, probably 93, 94. And years later, with the Hear the Watchman tour, they brought us back to the Little Alley Inn, and I lectured there. 20 years later, 25 years later, whatever it was, which totally blew me away. Because it's like I'm standing in the room where, you know, 93, 94, I was learning, and now I'm lecturing at the Little Alley Inn. How did I get here? It's just, you know, the Lord is amazing. I was telling somebody this the other day, you know, it's like, I think I said this last night too, but I'll reiterate it. We think we know who we are. We think we know what we want to do. Like, I'm a musician. I was a worship leader for 25 years. I had no idea. If you had told me 43 years ago, I'd be standing on this stage doing this, I would have gone, well, you're out of your mind. There's no way. Here we are. Because the Lord takes us, if we allow him, and he knows who we are and what he made us to do. And he'll take us and he'll move us into our destiny. He will do that, only if we let him. And a lot of times, you know, we kick against the goads. We go, well, I don't want to do that. And the Lord keeps going, no, but you don't understand. This is what I created you for. And he's always gentle. I mean, we spend time on the anvil in the forge of the living God, where he heats us up, puts us on the anvil, and pounds the living daylights out of us, right? That's what he does. We all know it. We've all been through it. Are we done yet? Not quite, L.A. We've got to go with the fire one more time. That's what he does. Hallelujah. Thank God he does it. So anyway, this is, it really isn't, we're going to change the title of this. It's really on abductions. And before I get there, this is really important. The rungs on the disclosure ladder. It's just a way of looking at how we're going up. People go, L.A., what's the top rung? I have no idea, because I don't know. We're on rung number 12 or 13, but how far does it go before full disclosure? No one knows that. 20 rungs, 30 rungs? You know, are we close? We don't know. So the first rung on the ladder, and we talked about this a little earlier, is Tucker Carlson with Commander David Fravor. It's on Fox News, it's 2017. And Tucker goes, there's what you see here is the tic-tac, one of the objects, a tic-tac-shaped object, something not from this earth. They have Commander David Fravor on, and it's 2017, it's December, and what was interesting is Paul McGuire in our film in 2016 when we filmed it, and I asked him, Paul, when do you think disclosure will happen? And Paul says, definitely by the end of 2017. That's what McGuire said on film in 2016. So he's totally right on. So it's December, it's Tucker Carlson, I'm watching Tucker, Commander David Fravor comes on, and Tucker's lead in is something like, UFOs used to be the stuff of tinfoil hat wearing people and conspiracy theorists. But maybe that's not the case anymore. Commander David Fravor joins us, former F-18 pilot who had an experience with a tic-tac-shaped object over the Pacific Ocean. I sit up in the chair, and there's Commander David Fravor, and there's a triptych. They show Tucker, Commander David Fravor, and the tic-tac-shaped object, the video from the gun sights of his F-18, they're rolling that, which is classified film. So they're rolling that, and Tucker asked David Fravor, you know, what was this, in your opinion? And Fravor looks right at the camera, and he says, something not from the earth. I go to Peggy, I go, that's it. Batten down the hatches, here we go. Phone's gonna ring off the hook. Oh my gosh, brace yourself, honey. It's gonna be unbelievable. What are we gonna do? Maybe we should get some other people up here to answer the phones and the emails. It's gonna be crazy. Flatline. I think we had one call or one email, something like that. Completely flatline. And that's when it clicked me that, oh, this is what the loud to see in church really looks like. Completely asleep at the wheel. You've just had the most unbelievable announcement on Fox News by an unknown pilot that no one's ever heard of. Commander David Fravor is not exactly a household name. Now it is. How does he get on Fox? Think about that. Let's do the backstory. Who calls up Tucker Carlson's producer and goes, hey, Tuck, or it's actually his producer, hey, Jane, this is Commander Frisbee, and it's Bob Frisbee from the United States, blah, 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 blah. And I was just wondering, we'd like to have this man come on Tucker next Friday and talk about UFOs. His name is Commander David Fravor. Oh, that's interesting. That's never going to happen. Oh, no, Jane, it will happen next Friday. Commander David Fravor will be on your Tucker Carlson show. It can be the last segment, but he will come on. Who's got the power to do that? Because where does this come from? How does Commander David Fravor, a complete unknown guy, no one knows, he doesn't have a book, doesn't have a DVD, he's not really good on camera, at least that's his first time on camera that I'm aware of. He's gotten a lot better since, but he's like kind of stiff and, you know, not really savvy when it comes to media. He's just an unknown guy. He's on Tucker Carlson's show. And he says they show Tucker, Commander David Fravor, and the F-18 gun sight showing a tic-tac-shaped object. It's a real UFO. There it is. Commander David Fravor, what was it like when it shot away? It shot away like out of like a bullet out of a gun. All I wanted to do was fly it. And then he goes, when I flew at it, he crossed the circle, it jammed my radar. That's an act of war. Then he was on 60 Minutes with his co-pilot, or his wingman, who was actually a female pilot, and she talked about it. So now we've got two witnesses plus the footage flatlined. Church, no response, phone doesn't ring, one email maybe, and that's when the light bulb really went off. Oh my gosh, oh my gosh. And that's when we took a hard look at what we were doing ministerial-wise and created this whole UFO series and books and everything else. I mean, we've always talked about it, but now it was like we've got to get this stuff out. As I said in the morning session, I'm on fire. I got three films to get out this year, and we will do it with the Lord's help. I mean, this is our marching orders, and that's what we're going to do. So the first step, the first rung of a disclosure letter, 2017 Commander David Fravor, how does he get on Tucker Carlson, and why Tucker Carlson? As I said last night, Tucker Carlson's audience is what? Conservative Christians. And so they throw it out to us to see what we'll do, and we don't do anything. We just sit there and hit the snooze button. And I'm not bagging on the church. I'm part of the church. But as a watchman, if I can use that expression, and that's the whole point of this conference, so we will not be deceived. We will know what we're looking at. We will realize that the enemy, the dragon, comes with all signs and lying wonders. End of story. That's what we're looking at here. And that's why I do what we do. Pentagon formally releases three Navy videos showing unidentified aerial phenomenon. So the Pentagon formally released it. You remember, these are the same people that are telling us in the 90s, UFOs are the stuff of, it's swamp gas reflecting the planet, it's the planet Venus reflecting the swamp gas with a weather balloon that's caught up in a flock of geese in a thermal pocket. Something like that, right? So it's like, these are the people that, oh, he's a conspiracy theorist. Remember, the conspiracy theorist was actually coined for anyone who disagreed with the Warren Commission's report that Lee Harvey Oswald was the lone assassin. He's got Maggie drawers. That means he can't shoot. And he's up there and he's going, I'm a patsy. And if you've ever been, I don't know how he got into this, but if you've ever been up in the sixth floor, in the school book depository on the sixth floor in the window, and you pretend you've got a rifle and you're sighting like this, could you do it? With a Mannlicher Carcano bolt action? With a faulty scope? I'm not buying that. Where the shot, as the JFK thing, is right here, where he's coming right at you. Where he's coming down Elm. Boom! That's the shot. Any moron would take that shot, because he's coming right at you. It's a turkey shoot. But no, Lee Harvey Oswald waits till he's a gazillion miles down the road, and the tree kind of obstructed the thing, and he pulls off the shot of the century. But the physics don't work because the head goes back into the left, back into the left, back into the left. Grassy knoll shooter, boom. Why am I getting into that? Because from that moment in time, everything changed. We've never had a country since. Never. That's free. They'll probably arrest me in the morning. Don't laugh. Don't laugh. I rebuke that in Jesus' name. But that's what happened. And eventually, I mean, on Tucker Carlson, going back to Tucker, what was it, a month ago? They had an ex-CIA guy on, right? And Tucker asked him point blank, was the agency involved in the JFK assassination? And this man said yes. And they were. It was a coup d'etat. It was a coup d'etat. Trump was never supposed to be elected. We never had a real president except for Reagan, and they tried to kill him too. And then he played ball. Trump wouldn't play ball, but I don't know why I'm down this rabbit hole. Somebody stop me, please. Somebody stop me. Unbelievable. Go, LA, go. USA, USA. So, where was I now? Trump was never supposed to be elected. Hillary was ahead in some polls by 16 points, and all of a sudden, the Rust Belt thing, Trump's ahead. So Obama and Hillary and a bunch of Democrats fly out to Detroit and Wisconsin to try to put a Band-Aid. No, it goes for Trump. The panhandle goes for Trump. The whole thing goes for Trump. Trump's there. There's something by an author called Lao Tzu, The Art of War. They use, and one of the things in Lao Tzu's book, The Art of War, you use the enemy's strength against him, which is exactly what they did to Donald Trump. They knew that he would get things done and get things done quickly. That's what he's known for, Operation Warp Speed. They used his strength against him, and he railroaded it through because he was told a bunch of lies, in my opinion. And if we're broadcasting that, we're all in trouble. What is the truth? So number two is Luis Elizondo. I showed you the clip. Luis Elizondo once again on Tucker Carlson, and they're talking about the mystery metal. Remember when you watched those weird sci-fi movies when you were a kid? Remember that? I'm like 72, so this is like in the late 50s, early 60s, and you'd hear that. And immediately go, oh my God, what's going to happen? The music signaled everything. It was so creepy. You'd go, oh, we're home. But you had to watch it anyway. So here we go. Where did that come from, L.A.? Material allegedly stored in the Pentagon is not from this earth. So again, this is Luis Elizondo on Tucker. Now I'm going, this is about 3 weeks after Commander David Faber's on. This is the second rung on the ladder. I'm on the phone with Gary Stearman. Are you seeing this? We're talking about this. Oh my gosh, this is happening. It's disclosure. The phone's going to blow up. Nothing. Folks, there it is. Pentagon is not from this earth. It's no longer me that is saying this. When Luis Elizondo was on 60 Minutes, I think I said this last night, and the interviewer goes, Mr. Elizondo, what is your opinion on UAPs? Notice they change the verbiage, and somehow that makes it okay. Unidentified aerial phenomena. We're all allowed to talk about that, but don't say UFO. So Elizondo shoots back and goes, who cares what I think? Your government, boom, is telling you that the phenomenon is real. What is the Christian response? And that's what we've been talking about all weekend. These are not extraterrestrials. If the Lord tells us, we see this in the Bible, specifically in the book of Revelation, that he's going to roll up the heavens like a scroll.
Oh, that's just allegory, L.A. You can't believe that God's really, how can he possibly roll up the universe like, that's ridiculous. That'll never happen.
Let me see, last time I checked, he was kind of walking on water. Right? Poof, you're healed of leprosy without touching you. Oh, you're blind, no problem. I mean, it's all... L.A., Jesus didn't do that. So, I mean, he's going to roll up the heavens like a scroll and create a new heaven and a new earth. I don't believe in the plurality of worlds. I think that this is it. We're it. The New Jerusalem comes where? It comes to planet Earth, not Zeta Reticuli. It comes here. Jesus came here. And I think we're it. I think we're in a holographic universe. And don't ask me how that works, because I don't know. But whatever this is, it's because these entities pop in, they manipulate space, time, matter, and energy in ways that defy our physics. We don't even know how they're doing this stuff, but they do it. People go floating through the walls, from the ceiling. How do they do that? All I know is he's going to roll up the heavens like a scroll when he comes here. And so I don't believe in the plurality of worlds. And of course, that goes against what scientists said. There's life. There's billions of planets out there, L.A. There's surely there's life somewhere. Fermi's paradox which we talked about last night, Fermi's paradox states that if the universe is so inhabited with all these entities, where are they? Not here. Instead, we get this cat and mouse game that's going on for decades with these entities. They're nefarious. Why are they nefarious? Because they take people against their will. You are kidnapped and you are raped. That's what happens. You are kidnapped and you are raped. So when I talk to New Agers, I go, how many people here think it's okay to abduct a 5-year-old boy and implant him? Anybody? Never a hand goes up. Not a hand. And I go, you've proven my point. You already know it's nefarious. You already know there's an evil agenda here, but you won't admit that because you want them to be your space brothers. But they're not your space brothers. I gotta go hug a tree, excuse me. So UFO metal mystery material allegedly stored by Pentagon is not from this earth. That's number two. There's Nick Pope. Notice it's the same guys. Luis Elizondo and Nick Pope. It's like, you know, they're kissing cousins. Nick's always there. Well, it's, you know, and he's got that English accent, which makes it even better on American TV. Well, you know, thank you for having me on talking about, I think that sounds like, what's his face? That doesn't sound like Nick. It sounds, never mind. So, you know, he's always with this English accent, and he's very, very, I've interviewed him. Nick's a really smart guy. But he's always there. He becomes the spokeshead, just like Jeremy Corbell. How come he's, it's the same group of people that get on and control the narrative. Why not bring somebody else on who's got a different perspective of this whole thing, right? From a biblical point of view, from a Christian point of view, they don't have that. They have everything else but. So Nick Pope says Pentagon does have mystery medals that came from UFOs, says former government insider. They've got the mystery medal. They've got it. And guess what? Rung number three, if it's there, it's outrageous the government is still hiding evidence of UFOs. So Christopher Mellon was in the agency, once in the agency, always in the agency, and he said on the record, on Tucker Carlson, that the government and Luis Elizondo and others have tested this mystery metal, and they have found isotopic ratios not found on this earth. So that's the third rung. One number, you know, here's the tic-tac shape. Now we've got the mystery metal. We've tested isotopic ratios not on this earth. What happens to my phone and my email? Nothing. Not a blip. We're on the third rung. And they keep rolling this out. Because number four is, Pentagon set to release classified UFO footings, off-world vehicles not made on this earth. The Pentagon has in its possession off-world vehicles not made on this earth. Circle back to 95 with Bob Lazar, who stated that he's working at S4, secret government base out in Nevada, Area 51. S4 is a subpart of Area 51. And he's working back engineering the propulsion system. He's not making it up. He's not. He was there. He did it. The sports model, the whole deal. And then the Pentagon, decades later, admits, oh yeah, we've got vehicles not made on this earth. Off-world vehicles not made on this earth. Off-world vehicles not made on this earth. So what do we do with this as Christians? How do we fit this into our biblical perspective? Some people go, well, this is all demonic delusion. No, it's not. It's nuts and bolts hardware. See, we have this truncated view. This is why the Lord is trying to get me to write this book, and I'm up to like chapter 6 or something. Supernatural technology found in the Bible. Excuse me. So when we read in Ezekiel, the angels come in to Jerusalem, they have what? They have slaughter weapons. What is a slaughter weapon? What's the magic inkhorn what the other angel puts the mark on the person? Don't touch them. But the two angels have slaughter weapons. See where I'm going with this? Goes back to the sword, which the sword that turns every which way in the Garden of Eden. How does that work? How does that work? What about the breastplate of the high priest? That lights up. 12 stones, one for each of the tribes, right? Priest wears these things. What does that spell? Can we do that over? Sorry, no. I mean, how does that work? It's supernatural technology. The breastplate of the high priest, the Urim and the Thummim, it's all there. It's technology. So, this is a sidebar. I think I have time. L.A., you better get going. You're only on number four. It's 1:27. I got to really be careful of the time here. So, but I'll tell you this one story. Damn the torpedoes. So I'm doing research on the breastplate of the high priest, and I find this article with a pastor from South Africa, but he's in Jerusalem at the time when he's doing this article. And I'm reading this thing, and I contact him, and we connect. Tells me this story. He's flown down to South Africa with a gemologist from Israel. They're met at the airport, top security. It's like limos with drivers and secret cards and this whole thing. They go out to some undisclosed location. They get out of the car, armed guards. They get into this secure facility. There's a vault. There's armed guards in the vault. Their contact goes in, takes this papyrus basket out, opens the papyrus basket. It's one of the gemstones from the breastplate of the high priest, which was handed down from a family over 1,000 years ago when the Crusaders went into Jerusalem and freed it from the Muslims. And this rabbi came out and presented it to the Crusader in thanks for freeing them from Islam. And this family has kept it for 1,000 years. And it's a whole chain of evidence of where it comes down. They put it in his hand. It's a dark stone. And as he puts it in his hand, the stone lights up. And he sees in the stone the letter Bet for Benjamin. And there's a wolf's head right next to it. And the gemologist is so freaked out, she won't even touch it. So she's looking at this thing and she's going, this is impossible because the letter Bet is made inside the stone along with the wolf's head, and there's no way to do that. There's no way you can create the letter Bet inside the stone. It's got to be made that way naturally. So just saying, technology, the thing lights up after how many thousands of years? So technology is there, and fallen angels and the good guys, we don't know. We don't know how they go back and forth. People, angels don't need a craft. We don't know that. We don't know. We see this much of a picture that's like this big. All I know is that these vehicles do stuff that is impossible from aeronautically. They make right angle turns. They accelerate at speeds that would kill anybody. But what's happening is this. Let's say this is the ship. This is the work of Bob Lazar. There's a gravity wave, which is bending space and time. So there is no acceleration to those inside the ship. You're just bending space and time like this and pulling the ship along. So you can make a right angle turn, never feel anything, because space and time for you in your craft doesn't exist. You're being pulled along. So, number four, leak reports from the Pentagon UFO Task Force discuss non-human technology mysterious objects. So once again, they're rolling it out. The Big Nothing Burger, preliminary assessment unidentified aerial phenomena out of 143 cases, 142, they couldn't figure out what they were. So this is the official report. And just so you know how incredible our government is and how your taxpayer dollar, our hard-earned PAC, you know where I'm going with this, right? You got to compare to what the government spends its money on. So the government spends a gazillion dollars on the effect of bovine flatulence on greenhouse gases. Thank you very much. So dare I say the word cow farts? Because that's what they are. Bovine flatulence on greenhouse gases, we get 1,000 pages. The preliminary UFO report, the most profound announcement in the history of mankind other than the resurrection of our Lord, right? 9 pages. We get 9 pages. 1,000 on bovine flatulence, that's important. 9 pages on UFOs. 9 pages. That's rung number five. Rung number six, NASA, never a straight answer, is hiring priests to prepare humans for contact with aliens. I wish I was making this up. I mean, 20 years ago, if I had come, you would say, that'll never happen, L.A. We're here, folks. We're here. And isn't it interesting, they're hiring priests. Excuse us. Can we have a couple of pastors in there? What's wrong with that? No, L.A., you guys are the rebels. You're the Protestants. You're protesting too much, I think. Thank you. So here we are. NASA is hiring priests, number six. Number seven, Bret Baier and I fell out of my chair. I mean, I was on the phone with Gary Stearman, and we were yakking for 45 minutes over this one. Bret Baier runs Bizarre Report, suggesting a link between UFOs and unexplained pregnancies. This is my wheelhouse. This is where we're going. This is the abduction phenomena. That's number seven. Number eight, Tucker Carlson hosts two butchers who believe aliens landing in UFOs are mutilating the cattle. Thank you for the reality check. We interviewed Chuck Sikowski a couple of weeks ago. This is number six in our UFO film series. We are in post-production. It is on cattle mutilations. And of course, number seven will be on Roswell. And number eight, what does this all mean? What is the truth? And we'll weigh in on that. Cattle mutilations are real, been going on for decades. Get this. The animal, they drain the blood completely from the animal. There is no blood left in the animal. They carve out different parts. They'll take out the anus. They'll take out the reproduction systems. They'll take out the udders. They'll core flesh from the jaw. They'll take out the eye. They're using that for something. Human blood and bovine blood are interchangeable. You can use bovine blood in a transfusion. You can use bovine blood in a human transfusion. You can. Don't believe me? Go on. Just check it out. WebMD. They don't do it, but they can use it. And in wartime, they did use it. In the third month of pregnancy, going back here to Bret Baier, unexplained pregnancies, a woman finds herself pregnant. She's overjoyed. In the third month of her pregnancy, she's re-abducted, but she doesn't know that. She wakes up either in the bed or in the bathroom, whatever, and she realizes that the baby is no longer there. But there's no miscarriage. She goes to the emergency room. There's no fetal tissue. Nothing. It's like never happened. The doctor looks at her and goes, are you sure you were pregnant? And she goes, talk to my OBGYN. We saw the heartbeat. We know I was pregnant. So the cattle mutilation, the blood and the tissue is to create artificial wombs, in my opinion. Now, I have never been on board talking to the Greys or reptilian shapeshifters. That's conjecture, but it's based on scores, hundreds of hours of research, talking to people who have been on board, and this is what they're doing. The seed of the dragon will be at enmity, at war with the seed of the woman. Can you imagine if I had started here on Friday? Most of you would have gotten up and left the room. Because it's way too much of a stretch. But I prepared you to go into the deep dive. Women are being taken against their will. They are raped. They are abducted, kidnapped, and raped. Oftentimes, they don't remember the actual act. With the men, sperm is taken from them. They are violated. Sometimes they are forced to have sex with a hybrid. Not making this up. I wish I was. After speaking to too many people who have been taken and abducted, it's unnerving. It's visceral. It's guttural. And Karen became the tentpole of that film. She was taken since she was 6 years old. And we'll get to her in just a little bit. So the cattle mutilations, which they've never, ever brought anyone to trial. There's never been any charges against anybody. Initially, oh, it's a satanic cult. No, it's not. There are no footprints around the cow. It's like it was dropped from an altitude. They drop it back in the farmer's field. If these were our benevolent space brothers, why not just take the carcass and drop it off in some ocean someplace? You're in a craft that can zip you from point A to point B in a nanosecond. So why are you dropping it back in the farmer's field to create the greatest amount of fear that they possibly could do? And these guys are terrified. They're terrified. What is the currency of the kingdom of darkness? Fear. What is the currency of the kingdom of heaven? Faith. Faith and fear cannot live together. We either walk in faith or we walk in fear. If we walk in fear, we're in the kingdom of darkness. If we walk in faith, we're with the Lord, believing that we don't see it, we don't understand how you're going to work it out, but I do know that you will bring good out of whatever comes into my life, because that's your job description. That's what you will do. I might not see it, I might not know it, but I declare it, even though I don't see it. I walk by faith that you will bring good into my life, into our life, into my family's life. And that's what you got to stand on. Either that or we cower in fear. So, cattle mutilations by Tucker Carlson. I mean, can you imagine this? That Fox News would run a thing on cattle mutilations? Is sure this isn't George Norrie? The ninth rung, take me to your leaders. Congress holds first public hearing on UFOs in 50 years. So here's the deal. It's a joke. Why is it a joke? Because the shadow government has been dealing with these eggheads since the 40s. They know exactly who it is they're dealing with. I've had people come up to me off the record. They won't come on the record because they can't. They work in underground, deep underground military bases next to the Greys. And they're terrified and they're freaked out. They come up to me going like, what do I do? And I go, you can't do anything. Either get out or whatever. Or they'll tell their parents or they'll tell their father who is, you know, and I get these reports from people side by side with the Greys. I'm wearing my gray socks right there. Side by side. I never want to see one. I have no interest in seeing one or having any contact with these. I mean, I don't, when I say I don't go looking for this stuff, I do not go looking. I do not sit out there at 2 o'clock in the morning looking for UFOs. I do not do it. It's none of my business. If the Lord wants me to see something, he'll bring it about. So the ninth rung, Congress holds this, you know, big public hearing, and it's just a big nothing burger. Skull and bowl types, vibes, spy agencies grapple with how much to share at the UFO hearing. Number 10, this is Gary Nolan. I've spoken to him before, specifically with the DNA results. He talks about interference syndrome. In other words, when a person is in the proximity of a UFO for a period of time, things will happen. They can get brain injuries. They'll get trauma to the brain. Karen had a tumor, and we prayed for her, and apparently the tumor is gone. We talked about that earlier. So this cracks me up, the 11th rung. What does Abby Hornacek know about alien abductions? You tell me. Abby, why are you doing this? Because you're a pretty face, and people will watch. And so it's amazing how they have the juxtaposition here. I mean, she's a very attractive, beautiful woman, and next to her is the juxtaposition is striking. It's almost like Beauty and the Beast. That's the 11th rung. And then Tucker's UFO files. The 12th rung on the ladder. Do you speak extraterrestrial? Science say Earth needs to prepare for an alien encounter now before it's too late. 13th rung on the ladder. We interviewed him. This is Robert Salas. He was the guy at the Maelstrom base. We interviewed him in our Watchers series. We're the first people ever to break his story. We broke the story in our Watchers series. We broke it. Now it's like everywhere. We were the first. Because he wouldn't share the story with anyone unless he had control of it. And so we gave him control. We said, sure, we'll show you the rough edit. You give us thumbs up, we'll go with it. You want something changed, we'll change it. He said, really? I said, yeah. So we did it. So he's at the Maelstrom Air Force Base in Montana, 1967. 60-foot orange craft UFO is over the gate to the base. 9 intercontinental ballistic missiles are switched off. No one touches them. They touch them. And this is why we're hearing now, seems like extraterrestrials are very interested in our nuclear capabilities. This is what they're preparing us for. What did I say earlier? Late David Flynn talked about a nuclear event somewhere on the planet. If that happens, it creates the greatest collective fear that humanity has ever known. That's when they show up as our saviors. That's the coming great deception. I'll say it again. The coming great deception is if it could happen this way. I'm not saying it will, but it could. A nuclear event will happen somewhere on the planet. The grid lights up. It creates the greatest collective fear that humanity has ever experienced together. Because we're all afraid, who's next? Is it going to erupt into a full-blown war? That's when they show up. They will say that they are our progenitors, that they created all life on this planet. They genetically manipulated early man. They started the world's religions. They started the world's earliest civilizations. And now at this critical juncture in humanity, they, E.T., our space brothers are back to usher mankind into a global golden age, which causes the great falling away that we read about in the 2 Thessalonians. Because you got to ask ourselves, what causes the church to fall away? What would cause you, you, and you to fall away from your faith? It's got to be something that's so incredible. I'm not doing this anymore. That's the truth. Yeah, those guys. Those guys. The neo-Darwinists are like I showed you last night. You know, Richard Dawkins. Well, I suppose it could have happened this way. Somewhere in the universe, a race of extraterrestrials that got there through some sort of evolutionary means might have seeded us here. And he's all happy with that thought. It's like, oh my gosh. They're running towards it. They're looking for this. They're running towards it. The 14th rung on the ladder, there's Robert Salas. This came out of Iraq. This is old news, but this is this week. This is devastating. Footage of UFOs over conflict zone seen for the first time. Bum, 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 bum. This is devastating. You need to be afraid. Be very afraid. Get the jab quickly. Get two jabs. Get boosters. Shut up. Nothing to see here. Keep. This has been around forever, but this is devastating. Oh my gosh, what are we going to do? I'll tell you what you're going to do. You're going to rebuke first and ask questions later. You see anything like that, the Lord rebuke you. Get out. I know who you are. Go away. Praise the Lord. That's where we are. This is where we are. You know, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, that this would be happening, but it's happening. And so how do we deal with it? We deal with it through a biblical perspective. We realize that Jesus warns us that Satan comes with all signs and lying wonders. Even the elect would be deceived. Unless those days were shortened, no flesh would survive. We're here. We're here. We're warned of this. We're warned of this, that the great falling away would happen. So I cry. You're going to go, oh my gosh, now what? Because life is going to, if we're still here, life will change radically. Radically. You think COVID changed everything? Wait till this happens. Everything changes. And this will usher in the new world order. This will usher in the global government, the global religion. Just think about this. How do you get 2 billion Christians, 1.5 billion Muslims, a billion Hindus, and everybody else under that? How do you get them all under this global system? How do you do that? Because the Bible tells us there's going to be a one world religious system, doesn't it? So that just doesn't appear out of nowhere. What mega lever do you pull back on that makes everybody go, oh, I see, Jesus was just a walk-in. Jesus was just one of their avatars that came to try to show us, just like Buddha, just like Krishna, just like, and maybe one of the ships, and I've heard this 50 years ago before I was a Christian. When they land, out will come all the avatars. Jesus will come out, wave to the crowd. You know, Muhammad, Buddha, Krishna, the whole crew waving to the crowd. That's a possibility. That's a possibility. Metaschismata, they have the ability to appear as anything. Do not be deceived. It's all about deception. So this is why when we look at things with our eyes and we go, oh my gosh, there's Jesus appearing out of the UFO. It looks exactly like him. How do you know that? By his pictures. So so what do you do? Your eyes are telling you there's Jesus, but your heart goes back to the biblical prophetic narrative and you say, that's not the Jesus I know. Because the Jesus I know comes at the end of the tribulation. And he comes and he lands on the Mount of Olives, and that baby splits in two. Guess what? Not on the Mount of Olives, check. Didn't split in two, check. Not coming in the clouds, check. No Armageddon, check. That's not Jesus. Checkmate. And that's what we do. What is the top rung? I have no idea. I honestly have no idea what the top rung is. The top rung is when they disclose everything. But they use this. This is almost our logo, and our company is called Spiral of Life, and it's Michelangelo's, what you see there, finger of God holding Adam. But instead of Adam's hand, we see God's finger like this, and then the DNA spiral underneath it. Spiral of Life. That's my company's logo. That's our company's logo, Spiral of Life. That's what they're preparing us for. So they take the imagery like this, where Michelangelo, Sistine Chapel, and instead of the finger of God, it's a four-finger ET. It's very, just the way my logo is very deliberate, that's very deliberate. What is it saying? In one, that's what's so genius about it. In one panel, it tells you that ET created us. What does that do? That goes against the biblical prophetic narrative. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. Now, we can believe that, and I believe that with all my heart. I say it every day, or we can believe the nonsense of what this is showing. It's completely, utterly anti-biblical. Do we understand that? What you are looking at there, I don't want to use the word blasphemous, but it's blasphemous. It is. Because that's not what the biblical prophetic narrative states. That's what they're trying to force on us. That's what they're trying to tell us. That is the lie. That is the coming great deception. That's the thing that will create the great falling away. But if you're sitting in this room, you will not be deceived. You will not be deceived. So here we go, abductions. Their seed, this is Daniel chapter 2. Their seed will mingle with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave to one another. If you don't know Genesis 3:15, and I had opened up with the statement, it would mean nothing to most of you. But now that you take a Genesis 3:15 statement, and we know it's a seed war, the seed of the dragon will be at war, at enmity with the seed of the woman. When we come to Daniel chapter 2, and we read, their seed will mingle with the seed of men. Well, who are they? It can't be the seed of men mingling with the seed of men. It's something else. This is why Genesis 3:15 is absolutely paramount. Because if we don't get Genesis 3:15, when we come to this, we're left scratching our heads and we don't know. But remember, the angel says to Daniel, seal up the words of this book until the time of the end. And then he goes and he tells us what the time of the end will look like. Men and women will run to and fro over the face of the earth, and knowledge will increase. What's happening as I speak? Men and women are flying all over the face of the earth. Knowledge increases exponentially every 6 months. We're here. And guess what? The book of Daniel is now unsealed. And now we look at the scripture and we say, their seed will mingle with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave to one another. And if we know our scripture, that immediately hails back to the days of Noah, where the seed is mingling, isn't it? In the days of Noah, the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair, took wives and went into them in the biblical sense. The Nephilim, the offspring of the fallen angels, is the Nephilim. But there was a marriage contract. They took wives in marriage. Their seed will mingle with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave. It's the same word used in the Genesis account where a man leaves his parents and cleaves to his wife. It's a marriage contract. So if we know the Genesis 3:15 narrative and the Genesis 6 narrative and how Adam cleaves to his wife and how a man leaves his parents and cleaves marriage to his wife, right? And vice versa. When we come to this, you put all the pieces of the jigsaw puzzle together. Their seed, whose seed? The seed of the fallen angels. The seed of the dragon will be at enmity at war with the seed of the woman. He, the Messiah, will crush the dragon's head. Their seed, whose seed? The fallen angel's seed, will mingle with the seed of men, but there's no marriage contract. Guess where we are? What happens to the women who are abducted? There's no marriage contract. They take what they want. They use you as a breeder. Same thing with the men. There's no marriage contract here. There's nothing good about it at all. in any way, shape, or form. This is evil beyond anything you can imagine. It is nefarious. It is right out of hell's kitchen. It is what it is. It is what it is. So, hybrids walking amongst us. Abduction, John Mack. And when he started doing this, he couldn't believe it. They couldn't believe it. Dr. David Jacobs, who we've interviewed in our Watchers series, walking among us. And we've talked about this before when I've interviewed him. He's an atheist. He scoffs at the fact that evoking the name of Jesus, invoking the name of Jesus can stop the abductions, but we know it does. But he and I agree on this, that the abduction phenomenon and the subsequent breeding program is very dangerous. He calls it the alien plan to control humanity. I call it the days of Noah, because we're right here. Alien abduction, Travis Walton. I've met Travis, I've prayed with Travis, specifically for a family issue and some other things. I was involved with him for a while. He was definitely taken on board. He said some things to me off record, basically stating and agreeing with me that these entities, whatever they were, are incredibly nefarious. And we've got Steven Spielberg's film series Taken. If you have not seen this film series, it is amazing because it is right on. It tells the viewer exactly what's happening, where it starts from with the Foo Fighters back in World War II, to Roswell, to the whole nine yards, the Black Eyed Kids, the whole thing. It's all there and Taken, except the last two or three episodes where their hybrid half human, half alien is not a man, it's a little girl, and she's got the power to stop time. Just take the little girl out of it and insert the Antichrist, and there you go. Because Chuck Missler, the late Chuck Missler, believes, as I do, that when they show up, that the Antichrist would boast some sort of alien connection. He's a hybrid. He's the son of perdition. He's the seed of Satan. You know, you just don't go to Antichrist school. Well, you know, we've got Bob and Jerry. They're pretty close here. I don't know. It gets a toss-up right now between Bob and Jerry. Either one of them could start. No, it doesn't work that way. He's the seed of the serpent. He's the seed of the dragon. All power goes into this clown. And I've got some ideas who it is, but I won't say anything. So then we've got... Sorry. You want me to do that cough? Sorry. Did you get it? Good. Okay. I can just see the tech guy back there. Slow it down further. I think he's saying... Okay, so here's Taken... And this is why Spielberg's movie is incredible. Look at the crop circle, right? Spielberg does a brilliant job on this. Brilliant job. And there, of course, is the huge ship in the government hangar. There are the black-eyed. See, the black-eyed kids, we broke a story on this, David Weberly in our Watchers series. There seems to be a progression of the hybrids. In the 90s, they're small, more alien-looking than human. They're very thin. They're sickly-looking, long, stringy blonde hair. Then moving into the 2000s, it shifts. They become healthier, except they're stunted. They look like children, but they're not children. And they're stocky and they're short, but they've got black eyes. And this is where we get the reports of the knock on the door, and you go to the door, and there's two kids with their heads down like this, and they say something like, "Is it food time yet?" And you go, "What? Is it food time yet?" And then they pick up their heads, and you see the solid black eyes. You're terrified. You slam the door. You run upstairs. You get your gun. You look out the window. They're gone. This is the black-eyed kids. They happened in the early 2000s. Now, that's not the case. Now we're getting hybrid people, male and female, that can pass as humans. Should I tell you one story? Yes. No, I'm not going to wait. You've got the meeting out of the palm of your hand, L.A. No, but seriously, this woman's in Walmart. Did I tell this yesterday? Okay. Walmart, if you want to see something... I'm sorry. But honestly, if you want to see what's going on, go to Walmart at like 2 in the morning. Take a friend and wear a firearm concealed, just in case. So you go to Walmart. She's at Walmart. It's like 3 o'clock in the afternoon or something. This is UFO brain fog of a nines. She's shopping. There were 2 or 3 other people in the aisle. She's getting something. A couple people here, one person down there. It's like 3 or 4 people in the aisle. Down the aisle walks a 12-foot woman. A 12-foot woman. How do we know this? Because the woman walked right by her. She came up to her waist. 12 foot. I said, are you sure it's not a guy in drag on stilts? She goes, no, no. Definitely female. No doubt about it. She was dressed sort of oddly, but she was 12 feet. I said, well, then what happened? We all, get this, we all looked at her. She went down the aisle. She turned and disappeared. Okay, then what happened? We all went back to shopping. That's called UFO brain fog. These are not the droids you're looking for. These are not the droids we're looking for. That's what it is. They can plant, I'll tell you one more story. They plant, they have the ability to control your mind, control what you see, control you, and tell you what to do. Case in point. Husband and wife were driving in Arizona with their 16-year-old son. And they're driving in the car, and they see on the side of a road a dead cow, which is really weird. So they get out of the car, they start walking to the dead cow. In front of them, next to the cow, maybe 20 feet away, is a man, appearing to be a man, in a brand new park ranger outfit, complete with dark sunglasses. Squeaky clean park ranger outfit. The problem is there's no park ranger car anywhere around. So he's standing next to the cow. They all go up and look at him. There's a brand new camera loaded with film in their car. No one ever thinks to take a picture. They go up and look at the cow. They don't say anything to the park ranger. They all turn around at the same time, go walking back to the car, get in the car, and go down the road. No one says a word about it for an hour. Then they start talking. So this is now 30 years, 40 years later. His son goes, L.A., what just happened? What happened so long ago? And I said, you were controlled. You were not supposed to be there. And that park ranger was not a park ranger. What you saw was a fallen angel appearing as a park ranger. The cattle was mutilated. Something happened, the cattle was dropped there, who knows? But they weren't supposed to be there. They can control. This is why you put on the armor of God and you see something, you rebuke first, you ask questions later, and we'll get into that in a little bit, I promise you. So, coming UFO invasion, here we go. This is the trailer.
Something very dark and disturbing is happening. It is a global phenomenon that knows no boundaries. It adheres to no cultural mores.
And the ones who are engaged in this nefarious activity do so with impunity.
People are being taken against their will. In the cover of darkness, in the dead of night, they are subjected to bizarre examinations that are often sexual in nature. These people are terrified, violated, confused, and with no place to turn to, as who would believe them? This is their story.
So can you imagine if we were here last night and I was showing this? It's like bedtime stories with L.A. So this is Karen. She became the tentpole, the centerpiece of the story. Karen was taken when she was 6 years old. And she began to tell people about what was happening to her. No one believed her, of course. And then she was threatened by them. And she was shown, and this is what they can do, visually in her mind, they can implant images. and they showed the aliens, so-called aliens, the fallen angels and the greys and the demons and the whole deal, showed her entire family becoming decapitated if she would say anything else, and that shut her right up. So she lived with this for decades. She lived with this for decades. It's more common than you think. Where do you go with it? Can you imagine going up and going, I think I've been abducted, I've been taken by aliens. Go back 20 years ago, you'd be laughed at. Well, maybe you should be on some medication. How's that sound? Can you imagine going to your pastor and saying that? And the pastor's got no reference for any of this. What does he do? If you don't know about, oh, here we go again. Oh, don't start on me. That good? Okay. Don't touch it, L.A. This is Emil. Emil is patient 17 that Jeremy Corbell took our film and used it in his film, Patient 17, without giving us credit. Now Jeremy Corbell is all over Fox News. That's how the game is played. You can hear my voice in the film. Never any credit to Watchers or Richard Shaw or L.A. Marzulli. That's Patient 17. That's Emil. He's the guy where we took out the implant in the knee. That's Emil. And he comes back in a decade later and talks about his abduction. This is Al Matthews, who became the centerpiece in the very first film. He was taken as a young boy over and over and over and over again. Abducted, kidnapped, and violated sexually. Same thing with Emil. This is Angela. And by the way, both Karen had three children by them. Angela had one. And when the women got together, I interviewed all four separately, and then we brought them all together in a Zoom chat. It was visceral, especially between Angela and Karen. So what do you do with this? Unless we know Genesis 3:15, none of it makes sense, right? Unless we know how Genesis 3:15 translates into modernity, their seed will mingle with the seed of men, but they will not cleave to them. Here we are. Their seed is mingling with the seed of men, but there's no marriage contract. They take, they rape, and then they come back in and expose the fetus. And they use the tissue from the cows and horses and other livestock to create artificial wombs. That sounds unbelievable. What was it, 2 or 3 weeks ago, we're talking about making artificial wombs for human beings? And it's national news? Are you kidding me? We're here. This is why he's got to come back soon. Because all the prophecies are lining up in ways that I've never seen it. He's got to, because he can't fix us anymore. That doesn't mean we walk hopeless. We should be walking in victory. One, because now you know the truth. Then the truth will set you free. And you will not be deceived. And you'll be able to minister to other people about this. And if someone comes up to you, a family member, and says, I saw a UFO, you'll be able to witness to them. You'll be able to talk to them. If someone confides in you, I think I've been taken, I have missing time, you'll be able to talk to them about it. You'll be able to witness. This is spiritual warfare. This is the deep. What does this have to do with salvation, L.A.? Absolutely stinking nothing. It has nothing to do with salvation. Salvation's here. Paul talks about that. We don't need to be talking about salvation. If you don't know Jesus, then you don't know him. And you need to know him because he will set you free. End of story. But salvation is here. It's in the shallow end of the pool. It's the pool. It's the beginning. I don't need a salvation message every day of my life. I'm saved. But now I'm in the deep end of the pool. I'm way over here. 12 feet, big diving board, you know, maybe 20 feet. Who knows? I'm in the deep end of the pool. I'm learning the secrets of the enemy. I'm learning about the heavenly war. I'm putting on the armor of God on a daily basis. I'm walking in victory, not because of me, but because of him and my steps. It's just like any biblical figure that we read. This is where we are. It's the deep end of the pool. It's mind-boggling, but here we are. And everything I've said is backed up by scripture. Every single thing I've said, except when I say conjecture, is backed up by scripture. Everything. It all goes back to Daniel chapter 2, all of it. All of it goes back there. And here's Karen.
I don't remember ever being up in the air. I remember being in the air, traveling, but I don't.
So this is Mike. I ask her a question. Do you remember? Well, just listen to what it is.
I don't remember ever being up in the air. I remember being in the air, traveling, but I don't have any ship-type memory.
Oh, sorry, hold on.
But at times,
It wasn't, I don't remember ever being up in the air. I remember being in the air, traveling, but I don't have any ship-type memories. I don't. But they would take me to a place, a facility. The walls were smooth and white and curved.
Hear that?
It's funny the things you remember when you're little. And there were other children. There were lots of other children there.
This is called UFO brain fog. So she doesn't remember being in the ship. Hear what she said? Well, I don't remember being in the ship, but I remember being in the air. And the walls were curved and white and smooth. It's like, you know, come on. And then she's in a facility, and there's children. There's lots of other children there. I believe in Holloman Air Force Base with Ike Eisenhower that he made a deal with them. Just like the Book of Enoch says, exactly like the Book of Enoch says, exactly. There was a quid pro quo. They couldn't come down. This is like the whole Dracula thing where, you know, Bela Lugosi, you've got to give Dracula permission to come in. You can't walk over the threshold. You got to invite him in. It's the same thing with these guys. They have to have permission. So allegedly, some of us who follow this stuff and have been in it for decades, Holloman Air Force Base, Ike goes missing for 24 hours. Oh, he had a nasty toothache, blah, 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 blah. That's a classic wag-the-dog story. Everybody nods their head collectively, goes back to a Sunday morning paper, and who cares, right? But we care, because we believe that Ike went to Holloman, met with these guys, and that's where the quid pro quo happened. Yes, give us the technology, just like the Book of Enoch. Give us the technology, we'll give you the women. We'll give you access to the population. But they were supposed to give us who they were taking and everything else, and they stopped doing that. Just, that's conjecture. I can't prove that. But that's based on research and research and research for decades. This is Emil. Listen to what he has to say.
But at times, it's weird. I can sense something in the room. And it makes you really frightened inside, like an animal that's about to get captured or something. And that's it in a short. I mean, I've just been tormented. I always told as a child that I was having nightmares and walking in my sleep. So they put locks on the doors and windows so I can't get out because they're afraid I'm going to drown in the pool. And they find me outside with everything still locked up. So you explain that to me.
So Emil was taken at a very young age, just like Al, just like Karen, and you heard his testimony. So they lock all the doors, they lock the windows, they put locks on everything, and they find Emil outside the next day. How's that possible? Let me tell you something. I told you this yesterday. I'll say it again. So this guy is in a jail cell. I'll say it this way this time. This man is in a jail cell. He's chained to a wall. There's a couple of other people with him. All of a sudden, this entity appears in the jail cell. This man's chains fall off. But the other two guys in the jail cell, they're still asleep. Then this entity kind of looks at the prison door, and it just opens up by itself. So this man and this entity walk out of the jail cell, and they look around, and all the guards are asleep. They're all, like, leaning up against the wall asleep. And then then they walk outside, and the gates of this prison open up magically by themselves, and they walk out. And when I say that, as I said last night, at New Age circles, oh, that's a classic abduction. That's in our Bibles. That's Peter's jailbreak. It's in our Bibles. See, we've got this truncated view of the supernatural. How does the angel get in there? He comes through the wall. How do people leave when they're abducted? They go through the wall, or they go through the ceiling, or they go through the closed window. These entities, both the good and the bad, have the ability to manipulate space, time, matter, and energy. And I just proved it to you by the biblical prophetic narrative. When Jesus rises from the dead and he appears to the apostles, I love this story. So the gentle Jesus, the Jesus that we all think we know, would do this. Hey guys, don't be alarmed. It's me, Jesus. I've risen from the dead. I'm going to come in now. Just sit down. It's all okay. I'll explain it. It's not what he does, right? All the guys are sitting there. They're all absolutely terrified. Jesus does. Ta-da! He pops through the wall, and there he is, and they're all going, oh, my God, a ghost, a ghost, a ghost. They're all totally freaked out. No, come here. Touch me. It's okay. And then he does something which is 100% guys. Girls don't do this, with all due respect, ladies. He looks at the guys and goes, what do you got to eat? Am I right? Am I right? Am I right? That's what he does. He goes, what do you got to eat? We got some fish. Can you imagine? He's sitting down going, pretty good. Who caught this? And they're all going like, they can't believe it. Uh-oh, what happened to my, oh, never mind. Hello. So get this. I went through the window or up through the ceiling.
I said, well, was the window in some way open by...
Let me go back there. So Karen is talking about she's being abducted and she goes through the window. The window is always closed. Or she goes up to the ceiling. Same thing with Emil. Up through the ceiling. Same thing with Angela. Al, he's driving in his car, okay? He gets switched off in the car, all right? Next thing, it's 3 hours later. Al's been violated. He's shaking like this. I mean, this is what they do. It's unbelievable. So then we interviewed Dr. David Jacobs, who's interviewed hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of abductees. Guess what he has to say?
I said, well, does the window in some way open by itself? And I say, no, it doesn't open by itself. Mm. And she says, I think I'm going right through the closed window. Oh. And she says to me, does anybody else ever report that? Not knowing that everybody reports that.
Bottom line is this. You go through the closed window, and you can't do that. That defies our physics. These entities, and that's why I use the Peter jailbreak thing, especially at UFO conferences, because they all, oh yeah, that's an abduction. I go, no, it's not. It's Peter's angel that came and rescued him. It's one of the good guys. We got to get over this truncated view of a supernatural that we have and realize that the guidebook of a supernatural tells us exactly what we're looking at. Because the good guys do it, the good angels. Guess what? The bad angels have the same abilities. They can manipulate space, time, matter, and energy. And that's exactly what we see in the abduction phenomenon. You go through the ceiling, you go through the window. Which is, of course, impossible, but that's what they do. And as Dr. David Jacobs says, does anybody else go through the closed window? Not realizing that everybody goes through the closed window, or the wall, or the ceiling. How does that work? I have no idea. Here's Emil. Oh. What happened? Oh, okay. So the picture behind Emil is when we took out the implant. Emil's a guy, years ago, we took out the implant. He came to us. He's not a Christian, by the way. I meet with him, try to meet with him every couple of months for lunch. And just, we talk. We talk shop and whatever. Are you okay? Anything happening? No. So when we took this out, his physiology changed when we took the implant out. Remember that implant. Whoever is putting that implant in people, no one's volunteering for this, okay? And the implant is, it's connected to the nervous system, not the circulatory system. And Dr. Roger Lear has seen them travel as he tried to take them out, seen them actually travel up a person's arm. There's Dr. Roger Lear. There's a CAT scan of the implant right there. That's the implant. That's the ultrasound on Emil's leg, where Dr. Matriciana, for about an hour and 20 minutes, tries to find the implant, and he can't. And as I said earlier, one prayer changes that. Father, if there are forces that are cloaking this device, I pray that you would break their power and do it soon. And this is what comes up right there. That's the implant right there. And everybody goes, what's that? And Dr. Matriciana goes, that is the implant. So here's Angela.
Okay, so you said you were 3 months pregnant, and then what happened?
I found out I was 3 months pregnant, and I went home, and a couple of weeks later, I started spotting, and you're not supposed to bleed when you're pregnant, so I knew something was wrong. And I was really upset because I had lost a child before. Mm-hmm. I was pregnant with my first son, Carolyn, full term, and he had a heart defect, and he passed away. So this was a year later. And it was really sad. So I was trying to keep it. I was trying to get my body right and hang on. And the doctor said, you probably passed this child over the weekend, and then you'll have to come back in and see us. It was so strange though, Yvonne, because they did an ultrasound and I saw the womb and I saw where the baby was supposed to be. And at first there was a heartbeat, the first time. There was a heartbeat, right? And you can see a baby when they're in there. You can see the dot inside your womb. But when I went and saw, when she did an ultrasound, the next time I went, there was nothing there. There was nothing.
What did they say? What did the doctor say?
They just said, this is the womb, but there's nothing there.
Having this weird feeling that I had more children, you know, it was just, it was bothering me. I woke up in the middle of the night, 2 or 3 in the morning, and there's 3 children standing by my bed. And at first, I wake up, I see them, and the first thing I thought is, oh, my kids are, what's the matter? My kids are here by the bed. I have 4 children. And they looked like my boys. And I said, one of my boys' names, what are you doing? And then, as you know, when you first wake up, you don't see very clear, plus there were contacts, and so it takes a while for my eyes to focus. And then I realized, wait, these aren't my boys, they're too short. My boys are taller than this. They're not as tall as my boys. And they started trying to pull me off the bed. But not physically with hands, but I felt them pulling me. And I'm like, no. In Jesus' name, no, I am not going. And they're pulling and I'm pulling back. And I'm like, nope, not this time. No. And I'm like, and it resists, it breaks the pull. And as soon as it pulled, and I'm paralyzed at this point. I've had, oh my gosh, I've had so many times where I've had that sleep paralysis. Same thing. I was having that sleep paralysis. I break out of that and I hit my husband. I'm like, why aren't you helping me? I'm like, why didn't you help me? He wakes up, he's like, what? I'm like, didn't you see them? Why didn't you help me?
He's completely off.
Completely out of it.
Is this your same husband that you were married to when you were 18?
Oh, no.
This is a different husband.
This is the one you met.
Right, and he's born again, spirit-filled. And
yes.
So let me ask you something. The 3 children that were standing there next to the bed, what did they look like? Did they look human or not human?
No. There were some features that reminded me of my kids. Okay, like one of my kids is in boot camp and they'll put pictures out with like 100 kids and I can find him every time. Do you know what I mean? You just, it's the, like the Where's Waldo,
but you're
really
change.
Good at it. And there were features that I recognized. And that's why immediately I just knew. I was like, and immediately I thought it was them because that's kind of where your mind first goes. And then I realized, nope, their faces were too big, were too fat, too round. They weren't, and they were too short. I've often, after that, I kind of looked into this a little bit because I was curious, and I've heard people talk about them being skinny or whatever. No, they seemed really stocky to me. Stocky.
But shorter than?
Shorter than my kids. Mm-hmm.
How tall were they?
Maybe 4 or 4.5 feet.
Did you look at the eyes at all?
I did, it was dark. Their eyes seem to be almost glowy, but not glowy. That's probably the wrong. They were dark and intense.
Larger than normal human beings?
Oh, yeah. Very much so.
So they were, without putting words in your mouth, is it safe to say that there was perhaps an alien component to the children that were there?
Oh, for sure. And what bothered me about it, and I really had to pray on this for a while, because at first, and I don't like that I felt this way. I wanted them to come back because I thought they're half me. That means there must be some God in them. And maybe they just need love and maybe I can find a way because they're alive. And I prayed on it and I knew that there was nothing in there. There was no soul. And I think what they're trying to, I think they're trying to manufacture souls. I think they're trying to figure out how to get a soul. They didn't have that. There was no compassion in their eye. You know, when you look at people, you see even some of the most damaged people in this world, you look at them, you can still see some kind of person, some kind of love, some kind of compassion, maybe just feeling in there. It was cold. It was just so cold. And I realized there was nothing there for me to save. And the best thing I could do was just pray and pray and pray it away that they never came back. But I don't want anything to do with them.
Yeah, what do you do with that? So she's impregnated three times, and they come and take the children, and then 20 years later, the hybrids show up, and you can hear her. They have no soul. They have no soul. And they're stocky. This is the black-eyed kids thing, I think. So they can't pass, but they want her. And they look at her with hate. You heard her say that. They glared at her. This is Al coming down after he's been in the ship.
After I was lowered in that beam of light with 5 hours of missing time, and I was shaking violently, I had wet my pants, I had known they violated me, I knew that for a fact, I went into the fetal position, but the reason why they totally shut me off, this is my belief, is because of the way I reacted, so fearful of this, they didn't want me letting other people know.
They have the power to shut you off.
Did they ever get close to you, face eyes to eyes, face to face, and then give you memories? You would see things in your mind.
Yes. That is funny that you say that. Yes.
What were some of the things?
The one that was the most poignant to me, and it was very poignant, and it was very early on in this process, because I was talking, I was telling people what was happening to me. And they told me I had to stop telling anyone what was happening. And they showed me all of my family members being beheaded in front of me.
So the backstory on this is Al, CGI. Al meets this woman. You're shaking your head. No, L.A., you forgot to do that. Quick, let's jump in the time machine and go back to last night. So this stuff, I mean, can you imagine if I had led with this last night? I mean, this is really heavy. I mean, it doesn't get any heavier than this. You're taken, you're abducted, you're raped. Then they come back and take your child, what you think is your child, but no one will believe you. I mean, this is, and it's happening. It's happening now. There might be people in this room that have had this happen and have never told anybody about it because they're too ashamed. Who would believe them? This is what we do. We help people through this. So this is Al. Al meets this woman. She's coming back from Kuwait. Al's a professional mover. She's got a big container coming from Kuwait, big shipping container. It's in about third or fourth floor of a freight elevator type thing. So he meets this woman, and she's a pretty gal. You know, doesn't see anything weird, except she's got this really dark sunglasses that like almost like a swimmer goggles wrapped around her head. And Al is like, they're in the freight elevator alone, and just the two of them. Diane is her name, and Al, and they're in the freight elevator alone, and Diane turns to him and whispers in her ear, in Al's ear, and he goes, they're listening, Al. And Al goes, who's listening? And she goes, never met this guy. You know, Al, the Grays. I know you've been taken many times, and I've been taken. We were supposed to meet on the ship. Creating hybrids. So Al gives her his phone number. And in the film, I go, mistake number one. And of course, she calls him up. And she's calling him up to try to, she wants to have sex with him. Hybrids always want to have sex. That's all. They want to create more hybrids. That's what the whole thing's about. Their seed will mingle with the seed of men, but they will not cleave to them. Now, you can take that and throw it away and pretend it's not in your Bible, or we can look at what we've been looking at and realizing we're here. Seal up the words, Daniel, for the time of the end. Men and women will run to and fro over the face of the earth. Knowledge will increase. We're here. The book is now open. You have people like me warning about this, telling us exactly how it relates back to Genesis 3:15, Genesis 6, and so on from there. So Al finally goes up. This woman is with her friend. They're drinking wine out of these huge goblets. And Al goes, oh my gosh, there's a deer fly on the side of your goblet, which is what you see there. So Al goes, let me get a tissue. I'll get it. She goes, no, I got it. She reaches down with her finger. She doesn't grab the fly. The fly sticks to her finger. And she brings it up to her mouth like this. And she just goes, she eats the fly. Next thing you know, she takes off the glasses, she goes over and she sits on, mounts Al, sits on his lap, face to face. She lifts up his shirt, Al doesn't do anything, and starts rubbing his chest and going, "My, you're well preserved." And I stop the, "Al, you've got a girlfriend. Is this normal behavior for you?" And he goes, no, because no one's ever challenged him that way. UFO brain fog. She goes to kiss him, and he pushes her away, and the eyes shapeshift. The seed of the dragon will be at war with the seed of the woman. So the eyes look like this when she shifted. And apparently, Al, according to Al's testimony, she let out the most evil laugh you've ever heard in your life. Al fled the area and went over to a mutual friend, Gordy, and they Skyped me. And we witnessed to Al for, I don't know, an hour on the phone, talked him off the ledge, and then we sent books and resources to him. He came of not been taken or abducted since. And he was taken from 6 or 7 years old. The seed of a dragon will be at war with the seed of the woman, Genesis 3:15. As it was in the days of Noah, so will be at the coming of a son of man. When we look at that scripture, what do we do with that? This is Jesus. It'll be like the days of Noah. Unless we understand Genesis 3:15, when we get to the days of Noah, is it really the Sethite theory? I mean, it's just a joke. The whole thing collapses. It makes no sense. But once we plug in the fallen angels, then everything makes perfect sense. Their seed is mingling with the seed of men, but they will not cleave to them. Here we are. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man, the return of Jesus. Their seed will mingle with the seed of men, but they will not cleave to them. So something is happening. Something is going on as we speak. We did this interview with Scott Carpenter. He's a Bigfoot researcher, so he has a camera on his backpack pointing behind him. So what you see here is something manifesting right here. And you'll see that in just a second. You'll see a perfect sphere right there. And there's the entity. There's the sphere, and there's the entity. This came in, people who were doing a Bible study using my work to warn people about UFOs. This is a game trail camera. So we get this swish like this. So the skeptics say, "Oh, that's some guy with a sheet or a tree branch, blah, 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 blah." So we had the kids go out and do it. And this is what came through. So this is what the game trail showed first. And this is the entity that manifested. Let me go back here. But look at the ears. Look at the eyes. It's 46 degrees. Low-cut bell sleeves, according to some women that I've talked to. Very androgynous figure. Look at the eyes. They're not round. They're horizontal. Look at the pointed ears. That's a better shot of it, sort of, you know, using different filters on it. Very androgynous looking. So here's a guy with the sheet. It looks nothing like that at all. And then the tree branch, I didn't show the tree branch. So there's a guy in Norway who sent me this picture of this woman, and he's at a market with his wife. This is a little graphic, but I need to talk about it, because if I don't, we don't understand that the hybrids have one thought. They want sex, they want a mate, they want to create more hybrids, and they don't care who it's with. That's why the women are taken against their will. They're taken, they're kidnapped, they're raped, because that's what it is. And then they become pregnant, then they're re-abducted, and the fetus is taken, the baby is taken, it's put in an artificial womb. 6 months later, whatever it is, gestation, there's a hybrid. I wish I was making this up, but I'm not. And it goes right into the biblical prophetic narrative. So we have answers to all this. This is the best kept secret of the enemy of the dragon's kingdom. This is what he doesn't want us to know. This is why if you were going to take one book out of the Bible, it's the book of Enoch, which tells you all about this stuff, which tells you that the dragon came down and had sex with the women and chimeras and all this other stuff were made, mingling of the seed. That's why you definitely, at all costs, get rid of the book of Enoch. So these people are in Norway. It's a beautiful summer day, and they're shopping. They're in the vegetable section, this guy and his wife. They're just shopping, minding their own business. All of a sudden, this woman appears at the end of the aisle, 40 feet away, something like this, 40 feet away. Out of nowhere, she appears. She doesn't walk down the aisle. She slithers down the aisle, not on her belly, but her feet aren't moving. So I'm trying to show you what it's like, but I can't do it because my feet are moving. So she's doing this like serpentine, but her feet aren't moving. Her feet are stationary. She's like floating, but serpentining like this down the aisle. He's terrified. The wife is hiding behind the vegetable stand. She's wearing these odd clothes that he's never seen anything like this before. And she's looking at him with unmitigated hate. The hate that's coming out of her towards him is demonic. It's unbelievable. She gets within 5 feet of him, and this is where it gets graphic. She's not wearing any underwear. He doesn't know that at the time. She lifts up her dress. Who would do that? Lifts up her dress, not wearing any underwear. The hybrids, all they think about is mating, sex, and sex. That's it. It's all this. They're soulless. They have no soul. And they're always thinking about mating. So this is where I'm not patting myself on the back because the Holy Spirit taught me this. And he's heard me say this. So this guy's in Norway and he listens to my stuff and he's read books and stuff. He remembers rebuke first and ask questions later. And he looks at her and he goes, "The Lord rebuke you." He said instantaneously, she's back down at the end of the aisle, 40 feet away. Just like she's right there and all of a sudden in a blink of an eye, boom. How does that happen? How can she move through space 30 or 40 feet? And she looks at him one more time with the same hate and then basically just disappears. They are walking amongst us. They are here. It is real. This is the coming great deception. We are in the end times. And I think what's really alarming to me is how it's increasing, how it's not going away. It's increasing, and it's increasing exponentially. And when we get reports from Tucker Carlson, as we climb up the disclosure ladder, just this week they talked about all the UFO from Mosul, the nefarious agenda. That's what we do. We're exposing the deception of the prince of the power of the air. All of our films do this. That's our that's our mission statement. So I'll leave you with this. You've sat through four presentations, and you will not be deceived. You will not be deceived. You will not be deceived. You know the truth. The truth has set you free. No matter what you see, no matter what they try to tell you, no matter what nonsense and propaganda they'll say with our space brothers or whatever, you know the truth. And we've done it from a biblical worldview. We've done it from the Bible. We pointed to the scriptures. I've led you all the way through from Genesis 3:15 to where we are now. That's it. That's the whole deal. This is the coming great deception. And when they show up, like I said earlier, everything changes. But I want you to stand up. Stand up. Oh, I guess that means us, LA. For a moment, I was confused. And I just want you to say, at the count of three, not yet, I will not be deceived. And just so you know, I'm going to take some, you'll sit down again. I'll take some questions if we have any. Do we have any questions? No, okay, not yet. So we're going to do 1, 2, 3, I will not be deceived. I'll answer some questions. I will be at the back table. I promise I will be back. Let me just go to the bathroom first, and I'll be at the back table. All right. Ready? 1, 2, 3. I will not be deceived. You can sit down. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, sir. Oh, my gosh. Have you ever heard of Sherman Ranch, Skinwalker Ranch? Yes, Skinwalker Ranch. What is your take on what is going on there? It's a gateway. It's a portal. Portals open. The Native Americans know exactly who it is. They avoid the place like the plague. And something will happen there eventually. Whether they catch it on film or not, I don't know. There also could be something buried there. Why are demons so interested in the solstices, the sun, the moon, and the certain locations on the earth? Really good question. They do this because they can do it. And originally, this was all hidden from mankind. Sariel, the fallen angel, was the one that gave all this information to mankind, the precession of the moon. They are obsessed with it. Why? I don't know. But this is their language. This is how they move. They move with mathematical precision, the equinoxes, the solstices, the 18 and a half year lunar cycle. They are obsessed with it. Why? I don't know. Have there been any reason given as to why the mounds were built? Is there anything inside or underneath them? Yeah, the bones, I'm sorry I didn't say that. Many giants are found in the mounds, 8, 9, 10, 12 footers. They're there. And of course, when someone finds one, this is 100 years ago, the Smithsonian would come in and manage the whole thing, and you'd never see them again. We have a site that we're looking at, which we're going to drone with ground-penetrating radar. So without digging into the mound, if there's a crypt there, that's what we go for. If there's a crypt, the ground-penetrating radar will show us where it is. We make a beeline to that. We don't disturb anything. We just uncover, look at, and then rebury. But we'll probably, if there's a fallen hair outside the mummy, or we'll take a hair sample. If it's a 9-footer, you better believe we'll be measuring that thing and filming in the whole deal. Do you believe there are life on other planets? No, I do not. I do not believe in the plurality of worlds. I said that earlier. I think that when Father God talks about rolling the heavens up like a scroll, I believe that's literal, and we go with him. How many people are abducted chosen? That's really interesting. There's something called the Stockholm Syndrome. A perfect example of that is Patty Hearst when she was abducted by the Symbionese Liberation Army. The Stockholm Syndrome is when you're taken and then you begin to side with your captors. Over a period of time, you befriend your captors. That's the Stockholm Syndrome. There's a book out by Preston Dennett who's interviewed this woman called Dolly. Dolly's a lifelong abductee like Karen. But she's flying the ships now because she's been there since she was 5 years old. They've taught her how to fly the ships. And she talks about that. That sounds crazy. She's had sex with the Greys, and she's proud of them. That's the Stockholm Syndrome on nines. So it's a complete flip from what we've learned here this weekend. Are the Greys fallen angels or demons? The Greys are, in my opinion, biological avatars created by the enemy to house the spirit, the disembodied spirits of the Nephilim. Fallen angels are fallen angels. The Nephilim, okay, were giants. Some of them were giants, but not all of them. But he's messing with the genome constantly. So the demons are the disembodied spirits of the Nephilim that are destroyed in the flood. They are the demons that are earthbound. They have to, in order for them to manifest, they have to inhabit something, whether it's an animal or a human being or an object. They have to inhabit something in order to manifest. So the dragon, Satan, goes, well, I'll just create an avatar. I'll create a body for the demons to inhabit. How do I know that? First time I read it was Whitley Strieber, where Whitley's on a ship and he opens up a drawer and there are the Greys, stacked up like chairs, like cordwood in the drawer. And he goes, what are they doing here? Same thing with Dolly. Dolly's on the ship. And in the first chapter, she even says it. Oh yeah, the Greys, they're just like avatars. They just inhabit the bodies, you know. So to me, the Greys are the disembodied spirits of the Nephilim. They are in a fixed state. And the Greys are avatars. They're biological constructs for the demons to inhabit. My source material on that is Whitley Strieber and Dolly. So I have two sources. That's not so bad. But also from other eyewitnesses that have had them. Do hybrids know they are hybrids? Can they be rebuked? Hybrids can be rebuked in the name of Jesus. They also know that they're in a fixed state. They're soulless. They are soulless. They have no soul. Only the Lord can give you a soul. That's it. Our soul comes from God, not from, you know, this raping of human. That's why the Nephilim are in a fixed state. That's why the Nephilim are soulless. That's why when we talk to people who have been taken or have been abducted, they talk about the lack of emotion that's there. The grays don't care about anything. They perform their task, and that's it. How does artificial intelligence and transhuman play into all of this? Of course it plays into all of this. Some people are saying that AI is an open, basically you're looking at modern day necromancy. And in some ways, I think you are. It allows entities from other dimensions, interdimensional gateways are open through AI, and these entities can come through. Same thing with CERN. When CERN is activated, it's opening up a gateway. It's opening up a portal. Be like the days of Noah. Noah was alive when they were trying to mess with Babel, the Tower of Babel. Noah was alive during that time. So that's all inclusive in the days of Noah. Do you believe there was a tie to Israel becoming a nation again in the Roswell event? Yeah. Gary Stearman and I have talked about this, absolutely. It's interesting that Roswell's in 47, the whole A-bomb thing happens with, you know, Nagasaki and Hiroshima and all this, and then the Roswell crash, and then 49, Israel becomes a nation, which sets, as Hal Lindsey taught us decades ago, sets the prophetic clock ticking. So we're here. The good news is you just stood up and you announced that you will not be deceived, like I will not be deceived. So, you know, we've got a ton of resources back there. Do whatever you want with them. Send them. Hold parties over at your house. They'll think you're crazy. But but hold parties and share with a friend. I mean, invite a bunch of people over. And, you know, and it's weird because even though Fox News is talking about it, most people still don't want to talk about it. Anyway, thank you guys so much for coming out. God bless you. Really appreciate it. Thank you. I'll see you at the table.